initially what happened is my mother called me. She was the first person to call me, and the phone was actually quite staticky. I couldn't really hear her. All I knew, she said something that had happened to my sister, and I just kind of like, I ended up actually hanging up the phone and calling back to just get a better connection. And then from that, it was pretty much, I called my older brother who lives in Virginia. I called him, I said, I don't know what's going on, but you know what I'm saying, this is the situation. We then got on a group FaceTime message and called my little brother, who was not able to get to his phone at the current time of everything was going on. But a couple minutes later, he called back. And then it just seemed like this stuff started coming through in waves. We knew there was an incident on the highway. I think at that point in time, it was a road rage incident. That's what we knew. We knew road rage. I think the initial phone call I got was road rage, Forest Park. She's supposed to be on a walk. She's not there. And then, like I said, things just started to unravel pretty fast after that.
I'm so sorry. I can imagine your sister must be very proud of you. What would she say?
She'd probably actually make fun of me for crying so much.
Not about you. What would she say to all of us?
To everybody, honestly, she would say that this was, I really don't know what she would actually say. To the public, I don't know what she would say. To the family, I definitely know what she would say. And it's very simple. Take care of Mason. Take care of her daughter.
How is she?
She's a fighter. She's a witted. She's a fighter. She's an excellent honor roll student. And that's not going to be lost in the midst of all of this. She's an honor roll student. She's a volleyball player. She's a track runner. She's a dancer. She's a very organized person. I think she's the most organized person I've ever seen in my life. And she has my sister made sure she had a very good lifestyle, and we're gonna try our best to maintain that level of normalcy for her. So like I said, I don't necessarily know what she would say to the St. Louis public. Definitely, I mean, I would hope that she would say that if anyone had any type of information to come forward and speak to, you know what I'm saying? If you don't want to deliver a message to the police, I'm sure they have, like I said, an anonymous hotline set up. But you know what I'm saying? If you want to just tell, you know what I'm saying? At this point, like, I'm taking everything. If it's a text message, if it's a tweet, you know, we're looking for everything. All information will be passed to the authorities. Like I said, at this point in time, we're just trying to give the authorities as many leads as they possibly can, because I know the harsh reality of this, and that is, you know what I'm saying, this is not going to affect everybody like it's affecting us. It's not going to be a situation where you guys are thinking about this 2 days later. And that's the reality of it, and that's no fault of you guys or anyone else. But while this is on your brain, while this is on in the front part of your memory, if anybody was traveling on I-70 and Olive, you know what I'm saying? I know it was a lot going on. I know there was traffic at that time, but to see vehicles swerving in and out of lanes, that's not normal. That's not normal activity. So you can't tell me that someone didn't see anything. You can't tell me that someone could hear those shots and just continue to drive and think that's normal activity for St. Louis. Again, I'm stressing this because this should not be accepted behavior for your community. Everyone should be offended and appalled. Everyone should be coming forward, because this is not, again, I need to stress this, this is not a situation where she was in the area of any imminent danger, knowing danger. She was on her way to go for a walk in one of the most nationally recognized parks in the country. This is everyday activity. This is someone who left and probably said goodbye and never came back. That's everyone in this room. Everyone in this room could be in the same position that we are in right now. Everyone viewing this could be in the same position that we're in right now. So I'm not asking for people to go out there as an Inspector Gadget or, you know what I'm saying? I'm not asking for no Dick Tracy type of response. All I'm asking for you to do is what I believe is the moral thing to do. And is that if you have information, to come forward and share that with the proper authorities. Or just share that. If you don't want to come forward, tell that to somebody who will. I know it's a lot to come forward and to have the attention on you. This is not something that I'm accustomed to doing. But the situation has presented itself and I have to do what I think my sister would want me to do. And this is exactly it. So like I said, going forward, and I'm gonna just continue to honor her memory, honor her name. And I'm gonna continue to make sure that her family is taken care of, that my family is taken care of. But I wanna make sure that the St. Louis community is making sure that our community is taken care of. The police can't do it all by themselves. We can't keep relying on the police and community activists to make everything right. Sometimes it's gonna take us stepping outside of our daily activities, stepping outside of ourselves to make a situation better. And that's what I truly believe. So as far as the interview, I definitely appreciate everyone being here. I'll say this. If anyone wants to do an exclusive interview with someone from the family, I'm willing to talk. We had to do this press conference because it was so much going on in the past 48 hours. It was so much attention put on our family, and we're not an attention-seeking family. And so this was the best course of action for us to kind of put out her general message. But if anyone wants to meet with me for an exclusive, like, I'm willing to talk. I'm not gonna stop. I'm never gonna get tired of saying Chrissy's name. I'm not gonna get tired talking about my sister. Like I said, man, that was my protector. That was my best friend. She was there when I got my first set of tattoos together with me. My mom was mad. She was there when we got matching tattoos. And so I'm going to just continue to uplift her, and I'm going to continue to live out her legacy. So.
Are either of her children here that might not say something about their mom?
I don't think at this time, I think I'm gonna be the spokesperson for the family. Like I said, you have a 16-year-old daughter that's involved in this, and I will speak to that relationship. That was not the normal 16-year-old daughter mother daughter relationship. There was no mom, I hate you. These were two individuals whose souls were intertwined, not even connected. They were intertwined. They had a relationship, and they have a relationship that I have never seen with any mother-daughter combination. Not on TV, not some made-up relationship on TV, not anything I've ever seen in the community, and different pockets that I have been in. This was a truly special relationship. That was her best friend. Her mom was truly her best friend, was truly the only person that really knew who she was. And now we have, as a collective, we have to put those pieces of the puzzle together, which is hard because now we're in a situation where we're trying to ask about her to make sure that we don't miss anything. And that's hard. That, you know, I have a 16-year-old niece who is now trying to figure out how to navigate her next 2 years. You know, it's important things coming up that as a family, we now have to talk and sit down and really figure out how we're gonna coordinate this. Like you said, we are a family that's spaced very geographically. We are spaced out all over this country. But I'll say one thing, within hours, my older brother caught a flight to get back here. Me and my brother hopped in a car together to get back here. So, you know, no matter the distance that we have between us, that love and that support, you know what I'm saying, it's gonna always bring us back here. And we're not going nowhere. My family's from here. So we'll be back, and we're going to continue to advocate, and we're going to continue to request that people come forward with information about my sister and this tragic accident.
One other quick question. What did Kristen do for a living? Where did she work?
She worked with IT. Okay. She was an IT specialist, so she worked in administration. And she loved her work, obviously, but even before the pandemic, she had the flexibility to work from home part-time. And she definitely rather enjoyed that because that gave her more time to talk to me and talk to other siblings and check up on her nieces and check up on her nephews. I know the last conversation that we had, she was just bragging about the Christmas items she had bought for my daughter, who obviously is her niece, and then my brother's son, her nephew, was telling me about all these gifts that she had and all these plans she had for Christmas. So, you know.
So, I'm sorry, did she work for, is it Wachovia, maybe now Wells Fargo?
SSM DePaul.
I'm sorry?
SSM.
Okay.
And she has two children, and how many grandchildren did you say?
One.
One, you said a boy?
Yes.
How old is he?
One.
One.
I'm sorry, how old?
One.
One-year-old grandson.
Yes.
And Fred, you grew up here, but you now are a community activist in Omaha?
Yes, ma'am.
Is that right? Okay.
Yeah, I work in higher education at the University of Nebraska at Omaha. But I also am a member of Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated, where I am very heavily involved in community engagement. I was very heavily involved with voter registration, social injustices, not only within the Omaha area, but throughout the nation. I serve on a multitude of different platforms that work with a lot of at-risk youth. That's where my passion is at, working with at-risk youth. So I started off with the Urban League of Nebraska.
How old are you now?
I'm now 32. Yes, sir.
Because of what you do for a living, if you were ever to meet up in court with these people who did this, what would you say to them?
That's an excellent question, sir. I could sit here and tell you that I would be angry. That's a true, honest opinion. I would be angry, I would be highly upset, and I would just want them to understand the seriousness of their act and just the senselessness of it. Like, you're shooting, there's a rolling gun battle on Highway 170. You could have shot your own mom. You honestly could have shot your own mom. You could have shot your sister. You could have shot your brother. You could have shot your own son if you were a father. You don't know where those bullets are landing. You know, if you shoot a gun in the air, the bullet has to land somewhere. What goes up must come down. And I think these people, you know, individuals, they gain access to these guns and they ultimately don't think about what the aftermath is. And if they do, they think about just that, the individual person, the target that they're trying to hurt. But with my sister being taken from us, this changes everything. This didn't just affect her. You know, this affected her daughter's life. This affected her son's life, her grandson's life. We now have to make sure and be very intentional at family gatherings when we talk about our family to have a picture of our sister present, instead of her sitting right next to me, cracking a joke, or sitting right next to me holding her grandson. We have to be intentional about keeping her memory alive for the kids that she knows now and the kids that may come after her, come after the relationship. So it's just, like I said, man, it's a really sad thing. I'm really hoping that people hear this story and really empathize with it, because like I said, man, we're not a family that's involved in any type of negative fashion. We by the way of society, the way society works and the way society sees things, we've done everything right. We cross off all the boxes. We check all the boxes. Like I said, we have a lot of different hats in this family. So,
what's Christmas and Kwanzaa, if you celebrate it, gonna be like this year?
Christmas is gonna be very hard. It's gonna be very hard. We usually get together as an entire family, just to show you how close we are. My older brother brings his entire family to St. Louis. I bring my entire family to St. Louis. My brother brings his entire family to St. Louis. My sister's family comes over. We meet at our parents' house and we have Christmas together. We get up early in the morning and we actually attend sunrise service before we even open up a single gift. And so Christmas this year is definitely going to look, it was going to look a whole lot different anyway because of the pandemic. We didn't have any plans really of bringing everybody together because we wanted to keep everyone safe. Christmas is going to be sad. There's no way around it. I'm not really looking forward to it anymore. It's more so about the kids at this point, making sure that there's always a gift or two or three or however many that have Chrissy's name on it, and they say from Chrissy. Yeah,
You're gonna have to get together this year, right?
Hmm?
You're gonna have to get together this year.
I wish I could say that we would have to get together, but again, with the pandemic, like we have older, we have older family members, so we have to protect them, and we have younger family members as well. So as a family, I know our hearts will all be in the same place. I just don't know if our physical will be this year. Any further questions? Like I said, if not, going forward, if there is a media outlet that wants to talk, that wants a quote-unquote exclusive interview, you can talk to me. I'm not going to stop talking about my sister ever. So I appreciate y'all for coming out. I guess I don't know the transition of all this, but I appreciate this. And like I said, just keep my sister's memory going. Keep her memory going, man. Keep us in your thoughts and your prayers. Yeah. I appreciate everybody.